Chapter 15. Domicile of Particular Persons, Soldiers and Sailors. Soldiers and Sailors in the War Marine. SS 297. Roman Law. In the Roman law, a soldier was considered as domiciled at the place where he served, unless he possessed property in the place where he held citizenship. Miles I by domicilium habervi to you by merit, senile in patria possidat. Donalus, in citing this passage, adds by way of explanation, quasi nemo adium locum ejecto, in quo ad militandum consister, et stipendium accipere cogitur. SS 298. French jurists. Such, however, is not the modern view. The French jurists, with few exceptions, hold that a soldier preserves his domicile of origin until he has manifested a contrary intention. De Milan, holding that the residence of a soldier in a garrison does not give him domicile there, classes it among pure residences ad tempus, which are far from excluding the hope of return, and which, besides, not having the effect of the choice and will of the persons, are not able to furnish proof of intention to change domicile. A soldier may, however, it has been held, establish his domicile where he is stationed in a garrison by the regular formal acts for which the French law makes provision. And when he has done so, he preserves that domicile notwithstanding he becomes stationed elsewhere, so long as the indication of another domicile does not result from a subsequent formal act. SS 299. Does a soldier necessarily become domiciled within the territory of the sovereign whom he serves? It has been held in England, by a confusion of the ideas of domicile and allegiance, that a person who enters the military or naval service of a foreign sovereign thereby acquires a domicile within the territories of that sovereign. It is upon this ground that the anomalous cases of involving the domicile of the servants of the East India Company have been explained. In this country, in an Alabama case involving liability for military service in the Confederate Army, it was held that the presumption of domicile arising from unexplained residence is greatly strengthened by enlistment in the military service of the government. Walker, C. J., remarking, a temporary military service may not be conclusive evidence of domicile, but it is certainly a fact powerfully contributing to establish the domicile. SS 300. ID. And this seems a much more reasonable doctrine than that apparently adopted in Great Britain, inasmuch as it leaves the fact of enlistment or accepting a commission open to explanation, as any other fact. It never was imagined, for example, that the large number of European officers who came to our assistance in our War of Independence and accepted commissions in the Continental Army became thereby domiciled in this country. Although some weight would doubtless have been attached to such fact in the case of a person of foreign birth who had previously been residing in the colonies, or who continued to reside here after his term of service was at an end, a powerful difficulty seems to lie in the way of applying the British doctrine to the case of one who enters the military service of a country composed of several states having different systems of laws. By what law would his civil status, or, in case of his death, his personal succession, be determined on the other hand? There is no such difficulty in applying the doctrine of the Alabama case, inasmuch as it supposes other facts which would serve to locate the domicile within some particular legal territory. But whichever doctrine may be accepted as correct, it can only be applicable to the case of one who voluntarily enters the military service. SS 301. Can a soldier acquire a foreign domicile? Hodgson v. de Beauchesne. If the British doctrine is sound, the converse should follow, namely, that one in the military or naval service of a country cannot, while in that service, acquire a domicile in a foreign country. This point was raised but not settled in the case of General Hodgson, who was a colonel in the service of the East India Company and a general in Her Majesty's service, limited to India, and who for 23 years resided in France under circumstances in many respects strongly indicative of domicile. Dr. Lushington, speaking for the Privy Council, said, "We do not think it necessary, for the decision of this case, that we should lay down as an absolute rule that no person being the colonel of a regiment in the service of the East India Company, and a general in the service of Her Majesty, can legally acquire a domicile in a foreign country. It is not necessary, for the decision of this case, to go so far, but we do say that there is a strong presumption of law against a person so circumstanced abandoning an English domicile and becoming the domiciled subject of a foreign power." Dicey remarks upon this language of the Privy Council. The matter becomes, in short, a question of evidence. There is the strongest presumption that D, who is in the service of the English crown, does not, even though he resides in France, mean to reside there permanently, but this presumption probably might be rebutted by sufficiently strong evidence. Great effect, however, appears to have been given to the fact of General Hodgson's military connection, and the fact that France was a foreign country, Lord Cranworth remarking during the course of the argument. If the deceased had gone to Scotland on furlough and resided there as long as he did in France, it would be difficult to say that he had not acquired a Scotch domicile. SS 302, ID, East India Cases. It has been held in some of the East India cases that officers in the military service of the company may acquire domicile in England or Scotland, but these cannot be accepted as authorities upon the general subject, inasmuch as the East India Company was at best but a quasi-sovereignty, and the countries mentioned were with it subject to the same supreme authority, and because, by a regulation of the company, officers who had attained a certain rank were expressly allowed to reside where they pleased, subject to the company's orders for return to duty, which, however, were rarely issued. SS 303, quasi-national and municipal domicile not affected by military service. The principle before discussed, whether it operates as a conclusive presumption of law or only as a presumption of fact, has application only to national domicile. Neither the quasi-national nor the municipal domicile of a person is affected by his enlistment or acceptance of a commission in the military or war marine service of his country. He does not thereby either lose the quasi-national or municipal domicile which he had when he entered the service, nor does he acquire a domicile at the place where he serves. The reason is twofold, namely, because his presence at the place where he is stationed is not of his own volition, but in obedience to the orders of his superiors, and because it is presumably but temporary, and in the absence of proof to the contrary, he is presumed to retain the animus revertendi when his term of service is at an end. In a recent English case, it was attempted to limit this doctrine to domicile of origin, but the court held that it applies also to acquired domicile. But, on the other hand, it is equally clear that he may by the proper act and intention change his domicile within the territory of the sovereign or country in whose service he is employed. Said Lord President Hope in Clark v. Newmarsh, it may happen, though a military appointment be the cause of residence, that the residence is of that fixed and permanent sort which excludes the idea of any other domicile remaining, and necessarily induces a new domicile in the country where the residence is established. Said Morton, J. and Moore v. Harvey, the defendant was in the military service subject to the orders of his superior officers. But it is not true, as contended by his counsel, that therefore he could not gain a new domicile in any place to which he was ordered. In all matters not involved in his military duties he was sui juris, and had the capacity to change his domicile to any place if he saw fit. Sailors in the Merchant Marine. SS 304. There is little that is peculiar with respect to the domicile of a sailor in the Merchant Marine, except that his mode of life furnishes fewer facts from which to judge of his animus than are usually furnished in the lives of other people, and therefore perhaps greater importance is to be attached to certain facts when they appear in his case than in the cases of others. But this is a matter of evidence solely. SS 305. A sailor in the Merchant Marine does not lose his domicile by following the sea, even though his absence is prolonged for years. But, on the other hand, there is nothing in the vocation of the sailor which of itself prevents him from changing his domicile to whatever place he sees fit. It has been said that a foreigner continuously and exclusively employed in the vessels of a nation may by length of time acquire a residence in that nation as effectually as though he had remained upon the land within its boundaries. But it will be seen that this is merely a principle of evidence. Such length of service, like length of residence on land, may be evidence of intention, but is not equivalent to it, and a change of domicile could not be held under such circumstances if animus revertendi appears. It was held in an English case that where no other facts appear a mariner will be considered a resident at the port to which his ship belongs. But this is only a prima facie which is very easily overcome. It has been held that a sailor is domiciled where he spends most of his time on shore, and doubtless this is usually true, but it is far from being universal or conclusive. For instance, in Aikman v. Aikman, a Scotchman during a maritime service of upwards of 30 years spent most of the intervals between his voyages in London, although occasionally visiting Scotland, and he was held to have retained his Scotch domicile. SS-306, residence of wife of great importance in determining the domicile of a sailor. Greater stress seems to be laid upon the residence of the wife as evidence of domicile in the case of a sailor than in other cases. But, as in other cases, the residence of the wife is not conclusive. In By's case, it was held that a sailor had changed his domicile from Holland to New York, although his wife and family remained behind him and he supported and occasionally visited them, it appearing that he had constantly but unavailingly endeavored to induce his wife to remove to America.